Ragin Edwards. I'm currently a senior manager of global sales operations for a company named PRJX Global. We specialize in recovery audit. We're basically a technology-driven financial services firm. We're heavy users of Sales Cloud, and I have been using Salesforce for 10, 11 years now, and in the admin capacity, but I also, you know, dabble in developer and do a lot of the looking at where we're going to go in the future, et cetera, with our Salesforce org. So, I'm also heavy in operations, so I do work on, you know, bringing new processes into the company to make our sales team more efficient, as well as, you know, tweaking some of the old processes we have. So I work a lot with different applications that I think we should add to the system as well. So I want this to be interactive, so please interrupt me at any time and ask me a question. That's what I'm here for. And if, as you see, this is called the instruments needed to be a rockstar admin. So just like I was able to succeed with Salesforce and, you know, change that into not just being a Salesforce admin, but being an operations leader, you know, I want you guys to be able to thrive as well. Okay? All right. So first, we're going to, of course, have to say thank you to our sponsors. We couldn't have done it without them. And we want to continue to have events like this for people in the Atlanta area. I actually live here too, so I love getting a chance to come down and just be an attendee as well. So let's start with the drums. So I look at the drums as the Appexchange. This is the beat you need to start to make your song, okay? As you probably know, there are thousands of different applications on the Appexchange. But the ones that I think are most useful for any Salesforce admin I've listed here, we'll just go down them, and again, interrupt me if you have any questions about any of these applications. The first is the Salesforce Adoption Dashboards. Now, these dashboards will allow you to see some user analytics with your users. So you can see what percentage of users are logging in, how many unique logins you have, how many people are logging in by role. So you may want to see, you may not want your execs in there because they may not come in there every day, but you may want to look at your sales reps or your service reps. So you have a few different ways to look at the amount of people that are coming into your org. And it's just really helpful as you're trying to determine what your benchmarks are for how often you want people to log into Salesforce, and you can see if they're actually doing it. Okay? The Salesforce CRM dashboards, these are dashboards that look a lot at leads and kind of your lead conversion rates. It also includes how many leads are being created, from which campaigns they're coming from. It gives you all of this information, all of the reports to back up the data in the dashboard in a few minutes after you upload it to your Salesforce org. One thing I will say is, you probably want to try all of these on your sandbox first, just to make sure it's something that you want in your system, and just to tweak it and configure it before you push it to your live instance, okay? Data.com clean assessment. This takes a look at your contacts and your account information, and it's going to make sure that, it's going to give you an idea of how accurate that information is with a percentage value. So the fields you have, like your DNB number, your number of employees, the annual net revenue, et cetera, that you have in your system for your account, you'll be able to see if that is actually accurate or not. And you'll be able to determine maybe you need to do something to get that information, you know, up to date. The data loader, I live by the data loader. I'm sure a lot of people use it. But the data loader allows you to make a lot of quick updates in bulk. And it also gives you your success and your error files so that you know how successful it was. And if there was an error in doing any of your uploads, it'll tell you exactly what that error was. I do use the version, even though you can use the version online, I like to download the version onto my hard drive and use that because it gives you a little more flexibility with your uploads. Or maybe it's because I'm old school and I'm just used to that format, but I like that one. Jitterbit. I really like Jitterbit. I think maybe you can only get like 30 days free. But it's a great tool. It's just like the data loader, but it allows you to use more file types. So you don't have to necessarily just use the CSV file if you don't want to. It also allows for automatic downloads or updates to the system. So if you want to put an update on a schedule and make sure that it updates, you know, once a day or once a week on a specific file, you can set that up. It's not very hard to figure out as well. You can definitely spend a day and figure out how to use Jitterbit, figure out how to do the automatic uploads, especially if you have an IT department, someone's willing to work with you, and you'll be able to get those on an automated update. The mass edit, mass update, mass delete. That's another one I really love. This allows you from the Salesforce UI to go and select, you can make a list, just like in your regular tabs, you can make a list view. You make that list view, and you're actually able to update anything in that list view in bulk. So if you know that some accounts or contacts or opportunities are marked a specific way and it should be changed, or you're using a new field value, you can literally go in, click the boxes next to those records, and update them all at the same time. You can also transfer users, et cetera. As you know, you can do that with accounts very fast, but if you transfer users to opportunities, that's more of a data loader type job, but you can do it right inside of Salesforce if you upload that mass edit, mass update, and mass delete. So I love that one. Dupe catcher, this is for the companies that have a lot of dupes and are putting in records fairly quickly, and people may not be searching before they're putting in records. The dupe catcher will stop someone from saving a new record if they find a duplicate. And you can weight different fields. So some people like to weight email high, while other people don't, because they may have a lot of emails that are just info@thecompany.com, depending on who they're contacting. So definitely pay attention to the types of rules that you put around dupe catcher, because you can set up rules that really make it more harmful than helpful for your reps to put in new records. A field trip. This is also good for the person that is using Salesforce and wants to, you know, update the fields, make sure that all of the fields are being used, or just even update to take out some of the fields that may not be being used. Field trip actually goes through your whole Salesforce instance. You do have to set up which types of records you want to go through. And it will tell you what percentage of the time these fields are being used. So you can see that, you know, if a specific field is only being used 2% of the time, you can take it out of your page layout, because really, is that really helping you? And on the other side, you can see fields that are being used 100% of the time. So you can also determine what other field or what other options could I put in that field that will give us more information to help my seller sell or help my customer service team, you know, be even better as they speak to our customers. Link Point 360, this is an app that actually attaches to your email, your Outlook. So even though I do love the Outlook, you know, Salesforce plugin, Link Point allows you to add tasks, et cetera, to your Salesforce instance as well. So if you have a lot of people that are using a lot of email and they want to do follow-up tasks, they can do that straight through their Outlook. They don't have to leave their Outlook. They can set up those tasks to call back someone or to email someone. And that's just going to, anything that's going to save you a few seconds saves time on the end, and you'll end up with an hour extra a week that you have someone selling or, you know, addressing customers' problems rather than doing a manual task. So I do believe in trying to save a minute a day if you can. Or a few, 10, at least 10. Did I have any questions on any of the apps that I spoke about? Or does anyone have another app that they feel is one that they love to use and very helpful? Okay.
Well, I have a question right here.
Sure.
Now, you categorize these as affordable.
Yes.
Are some of them free?
Most of them are free. The only ones that are not free are Jitterbit and Link Point 360. The rest of them are free.
Field trip is a great app.
Yes, it's, I mean, when we were updating our Salesforce instance, I was like, yeah, we can talk, but we're gonna do field trip first and then let's have a discussion, because I know you guys wanna keep these fields, but nobody's using them, so. Oops. All right, so now we need our base. We need that. That's going to get us in the groove, right? So our base is Trailhead. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with Trailhead. Has anyone not heard of Trailhead? Okay, you all have, good. So Trailhead is a great way to learn Salesforce. When I started using Salesforce, you could literally call and they would tell you everything you needed to know. And it was wonderful. That's how I was self-taught, because I would call and be on the phone for like an hour, and then I got a guy that I talked to all the time. So, but you know, with how big Salesforce is, now they have released Trailhead, which allows you to go through different modules, trails are groups of modules, projects, which give you step-by-step instructions on how to complete specific actions that customize your org or building new apps, et cetera. You can get badges. So, you know, you may not be certified in Salesforce as an admin, but definitely if you have, you know, 20, 30 badges on your LinkedIn page, you know, that's going to let someone know that you do know Salesforce, even though you may not be certified. But it's always good to get that certification as well. And then there's super badges, which I'm working on my first super badge now. Super badges basically combine projects and different trails to show that you are definitely proficient in an area. And you also go through an actual project where you have to build something. So you are not just answering questions like most of the trails, you are actually doing it and putting it into action. So those are, I was having a good time trying to get my super badge, and I was like, I thought I was done, and then they're like, no, you have one more project. So definitely make sure to kind of pace yourself as well as you're going through these different items. And I'm gonna go into a little bit more. As you can see, when you go to trailhead.com, you'll see the different trails. At this time, I think there were 53 trails, but now there are 56. So even in the time where I created this deck till now, there are more trails. There are trails that have to do with learning how to be a Salesforce consultant and starting your consultant business, to security and making sure that your Salesforce org is secure. So you can definitely go through them and figure out which ones you want to do. And they are wonderful. You also, again, get to get those badges after you finish them. And you get points for the badges, and you can show them off in your Salesforce community groups as well. So I do definitely think that you should check that out if you haven't already. The units and modules, this is an example of the Salesforce Platinum Basics. It tells you right in the beginning what units you're going to have to go through. And the good thing about it is it also gives you a time frame of how long it's going to take. So that allows you to set up your day or set up your week so that you can, what I do is I literally block time off my calendar, make sure that I can get that module done, and I do it because I feel like if this is learning at my job, you know what I mean? I'm learning to do a better, so I can be a better Salesforce admin. So I literally block time off to get these done, and you know, not all, every week, all week, but definitely if there's one that I need to learn. I don't know if your company would be happy with that. But definitely if there's one that I really want to learn, I definitely go through it. And as you can see, it allows you to tweet and put it on Facebook and put it on LinkedIn as well. The badges and the super badges. This is an example. Well, this is my LinkedIn page. And as you can see, this is when I had 8 certifications. So I was really wanted to roll out lightning, but I also wanted to show everyone that I knew what I was doing. So I went ahead and got every lightning badge that they had at that time. And this is also posted on your LinkedIn page. So not that I'm looking for another position, but you even get people reaching out to you, asking you how did it go, et cetera, and people asking you for jobs too. So for those that are looking for jobs, this is a great way to show your expertise in Salesforce and how you've gone above and beyond just to get a certification. You're really a user, a super user. The time needed to complete the trails ranges from an hour and a half to 17 hours. So again, like I said, it's good to kind of plan how you want to do it so that you can get them done and you're not just have a whole bunch of them hanging out there. Especially some of the super badges, you have to do different modules to get them. So plan it out. That's the best way to get the most badges as quick as possible. Anybody have any questions about Trailhead and the badges? And yes.
So I'm new to LinkedIn.
Mm-hmm.
So
what you're going to have to do, I think you can just do it through your profile and tell, and there's just an area where you can say, put on LinkedIn. I normally do it right when I finish it because there's, because it comes up and you can put it there. But there is a way to do it because I had to do it with, I think it was that data management badge, one of those badges. I had to put it on after. So it's just go through it. You'll be able to figure it out. It's not that hard at all. If I can figure it out, you can definitely figure it out. All right, so now we got the drums, we got the bass. Now we need to add that, you know, that treble sound. So we got our guitars and our keyboard, that melody. So that's going to be your success community, and that's just success, your success website from Salesforce. And there are a lot of different areas to explore. Answers, I love answers. So answers is where you can ask the question to just people that use Salesforce, anyone that is a member of the success community. They can go and look at the questions and they give you answers. Steve Mo was a big guy on there, and he's just been surpassed by another user, has been answering all the questions, and they're just very knowledgeable people that want to help you out because they understand how it is to be a Salesforce admin and needing to make one specific formula and you just can't make it work. Definitely go on the answers. First search for the question because 9 times out of 10, someone asked it before. So the answer is probably already there. But if you cannot find the same question, definitely put in a question and people answer them fairly quickly. Like I would say under a day, 99% of the time, someone will come and answer. And they're all people that are like just Salesforce experts, do it every day in their job most of the time. The help and training, Salesforce's knowledge database is so huge right now. It has everything from documents to videos, and any question that you have on any specific area in Salesforce, you can definitely go in there, try to figure out the answer. It also has PDFs that you can pull out and look at step-by-step guides to implement different processes that you want to via Salesforce. Events. So I have become really active in our local Atlanta area Salesforce community. And there is the Atlanta Salesforce Users Group. There is the Service Breakfast Group. There is the Women in Tech Group for Atlanta. There are so many groups that you can join and go to their events. And well, actually that's more collaboration, but the events also speak to those as well. Another event would have been Southeast Dreamin, you know, different Salesforce-led events. Now, collaboration, those are the groups you can join. So there may be, if you're a nonprofit, there's a nonprofit group where you can join and speak to other people that have the same type of configuration issues or wishes that you may have. And you can reach out to them and say, hey, I want to set up a donations, page. How do I do that? That, you know, sends a text message and or even bounce different ideas off of people and how and figure out the best way to initiate, start, you know, and roll out a new process. Ideas. So I think that is one of the probably most important areas of Salesforce, I would guess, because I've seen people put ideas for their next, you know, release, and Salesforce really implements it. And I think that's why it has such a huge following, especially from people that are admins, because when we ask them to do something, a lot of times, if it makes sense, they will do it. And there are many ideas in there, and there are a lot of ideas that definitely came in the next release. So I do suggest that you, if you have an idea for Salesforce, something that they should build, a process that they should make easier, definitely go ahead and put in an idea and also look at other ideas people have had so you can kind of, it also kind of lets you think about, what could I be doing that I'm not doing that they figured out? Yes. Yes, and you can vote as well. So you can figure out what the best idea is or if you think it's a great idea, you know, vote, get your other admin friends in your groups to vote on it and then it'll, you know, be at the top. So So yes, you're definitely right about that. So did I have any questions about the success community and kind of the benefits to being on that? Okay. Yes.
Mm-hmm. All kinds of stuff, whereas health and training is a little more narrow.
Mm-hmm.
So that's always my go-to place when I'm looking for something is Google first.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can get, it'll give you the health and training results as well as all of this other stuff.
Right.
You don't know what you're looking for, maybe.
Mm-hmm. I think there's a couple blogs that have a huge following that a lot of times, especially if you're like into making formulas and triggers and things like that, because they're still developer force, if you want to get into the developer side, that if you have, you want to make a kind of an easy trigger and you're not too worried about messing with code, you can do that as well. So I do agree, I do that. Sometimes when I can't find the answer that I want in answers, then I might go to Google to see what someone else that had a blog may have said. But I think that's a great point. All right. Okay, so now you have to get that lead singer, that person that has that voice that makes everyone want to say, okay, who is this band? Who is this new band? So open communication is the key to a successful Salesforce org. That means you are reaching out to the different departments in the company that your Salesforce org touches, and you are making sure that you understand what their needs are, as well as what your vision and what, you know, the team as a whole vision is for the future of Salesforce in your organization. First, I like to start with making sure that my yearly goals as an admin with my Salesforce org align with the yearly goals of my company. So if my yearly goals are, one of our sales goals may be, we want to turn around contracts quicker. We want to make that process faster. It takes us too long to get contracts signed. Then I start to think, what can I do in Salesforce that will help them get contracts signed faster? Okay, well maybe if we captured a little more information, added a few fields that help it go through legal a little bit faster. What if we automated a process in Salesforce, because Salesforce does have approvals in that functionality. So maybe I should look at rolling out approvals in Salesforce so that, you know, every lawyer and every approver can get the contract at the same time and collaborate, rather than it maybe going around, you know, the old-fashioned way in paper. Identify key stakeholders within every department that uses Salesforce. So you're gonna have all your type of people. You're gonna have your early adopters, and you're gonna have your people that don't wanna use it. It's just gonna happen, okay? So the best thing to do is to leverage those people that really like Salesforce and really like to use it. And those need to become some of your best friends, because those people are the ones that are gonna push your, you know, your future vision of your Salesforce org. Those are the people that are gonna give you the backing needed within your company, whether it's budget or whether it's just putting on a total new division in your company, because it will streamline processes to have finance, to have logins. You have to make sure those people are your friends and understand that you're there to help them. You're not trying to give them any extra work. You just want to help them get everything they need to be done faster, quicker, better. Have monthly meetings with your groups of key stakeholders and discuss the current state of Salesforce, as well as proposed changes to the system. So this is more of a psychological thing than anything. If you tell someone to do something, you may get a little hesitation. But if you make them feel like they're a part of the solution, they're gonna be more willing to adopt a new practice or a new process, especially if they're in that conversation. So we're making sure that everyone has a voice, everyone feels that ownership of that Salesforce org and feels like it's theirs and their tool to use. So it's definitely, it works in process, but it's definitely a psychological thing as well. Identify your super users. Now your super users would be one of your users, one of your customer service team, or one of your sales team members that are always in Salesforce, the ones that are asking you, hey, I want to make a report that looks like this, and want you to tell them how to do it versus you just making it for them. Those people always have the best ideas in how to make Salesforce work better, and they're always very vocal about how to do that. So you leverage those people. You stay in contact with them just like you do your stakeholders, and you ask them, hey, you know, what's going on? How do you like this new, you know, these new fields that we put in? Do you like the new, do you like Lightning? Do you think we should change anything in our configuration, et cetera? And they're the ones that normally want to push you forward in which more, you know, more divisions of your company were on Salesforce. So definitely reach out to them because they're the ones that's in it every day. And they always have the best ways to get other users to use it as well because they're used to using it. So I love my super users. Designate chatter champions to moderate chatter groups. So you also want to, good leaders know how to give other people things to do. You don't want to try to do everything yourself, okay, because it's not going to work, all right? And then you're not focusing on anything if you're trying to do everything, you're spread out. So if you have chatter implemented in your company, make sure to get whatever type of chatter group you have, whether it's based on geography or based on service line or some other vertical. Designate a chatter champion, and it's usually that super user, and you tell them, hey, can you please make sure to make a couple posts a week? Just do 2 posts a week. You know, that's doable for most people, especially if they're in Salesforce every day. So that's what I like to tell them. Hey, just do 2 posts a week, and it will start to create a monster of its own, and they will get more people to use it, et cetera. Always good to also have good knowledge pieces, information internally in your company that most people would know, but sometimes everyone's not privy to because maybe they just didn't check their email. That happens too. So definitely use it to spread information internally. And that also helps with your company culture. So if you're in some sort of branding exercise or changing your company in a specific way, chatter is a great way to elicit those changes because you can set that tone in those chatter groups. Okay? You have to keep the executive or leadership teams aware of the current state of Salesforce and the plans for the future. So Salesforce is an investment and a large investment for some companies. If for some reason people aren't updating the system and now the information is not as accurate as it needs to be, you need to let somebody know about that and not try to just be cleaning up that mess all the time, because your executive team in Salesforce will tell you it has to be pushed down from the top. Usage practices have to be pushed down from the top, because you can tell people all day, you need to update Salesforce, you need to do this, you need to do that, stop doing this, but they are not going to do it unless they know that their pay depends on it, okay? So make sure that they know what's going on, and, you know, don't, you know, they are executives, so they don't have time to mess with little, you know, John is not updating, they don't have time for that, but make sure they understand where it is at this time, as well as where you think it can grow and where you think it can go to help the company, okay? Because you want to be this rock star, that voice that they want to hear, okay? And last, now that we have all of our instruments, you're the singer now, you want to record your songs, okay? And you record your songs through making sure that you are reporting out of Salesforce fairly frequently so that, and I also say this because it's amazing how many times I make reports for our senior leadership team, for our board members, et cetera, but it's amazing how someone will just come up with a report that we've never pulled and never looked at the information that way before, and they'll be like, yeah, could you go back a year and tell me the change over a year? And it's good to pull the information so that just in case somebody needs it, you have it there. And you can, you know, compile it, put it together. I would say if you don't already pull specific reports on a scheduled basis, when you guys get back to your office, start pulling reports. And the types of reports that are best are activity reports. So you want to see how many phone calls are being made, how many emails are being, you know, sent out. How many meetings are going on? How many conference, you can go to campaigns. How many conference attendees do we have normally, depending on your type of job, how many different events you have that go on. You may want to make sure that you record that type of stuff. How many records were created? So how many accounts did we create this month? How many contacts did we create this month versus last month? How many opportunities were created? How many opportunities closed? Because when you start, as an executive, if you start to pull this information and they start to look at it, they are better able to forecast for what's coming in the next year or budget for what they're gonna get in the next year if they can see the trend of what's been happening over the past year. And I have never, as I would say most of the jobs that I've started, no one asks me for this. No one asks me for it. But I do it because I know that when they see it, they're always like, oh my gosh, really? Well, what happened here? Well, what happened in October? I thought October was our biggest month. No, actually it's not, you know? So you're giving them information that they didn't previously have that's gonna make you look like a rock star, okay? you wanna, as I said, pull the same report monthly or quarterly so that you're getting that information. Again, we all work in orgs. Some of them are bigger than others. And sometimes people go in and change information depending on the rules that you have in Salesforce. So you wanna make sure that you have your own kind of backup into what happened, because as we know, people will change amounts and you'll be wondering why this changed. And if you don't have your field history set up correctly, you may not know why this specific type of opportunity had such a dip, et cetera. It's good to just get that information out of the system so that if you ever need to go back to it, you can figure out what changed and why your numbers aren't looking like you thought they would look. Okay? That goes back through field trip.
Last thing, create a user survey. So again, Salesforce's success in your organization depends on the frequency and the accuracy that the people that use it, you know, have. So you want to ask them, and again, this goes into making them feel like they're a part of that team, making them feel that they have some sort of ownership in Salesforce.
So you want to make sure to ask them, not a long survey, because nobody likes to answer a long survey, okay, 10 questions or less, about, you know, what do they like about Salesforce? What do they think about the new things that we implemented? How do they like Lightning? If they could change one thing about Salesforce, what would it be? Is there something that you think we should start capturing that, or something that some process that we should initiate that will make you more efficient, et cetera? Just like Salesforce uses the ideas to actually change how Salesforce works, you need to take on that same model. Use the ideas of the people that use it every day to determine the best next place to go in Salesforce. Okay? Did I have any questions? And again, the questions, oh, yeah.
Question, is there a survey tool in Salesforce?
There.
I have used SurveyMonkey before, but I'd love to
In Salesforce, yes, there is. There's actually, now on Chatter, there's a polling area where you can actually make a poll right on Salesforce in Chatter. You can add everybody or send it out to your group, and they can actually weigh in. You can put the different questions there. They can weigh in, and you can tell them how you can. Yeah, I think I've seen that, but I've never used it personally.
What? I forget the name. I think it's called Salesforce.
Survey Force? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that's always, and always be open.
Polling is for Chatter, right? Chatter is enabled in all the
issues. Yes, it's on Chatter, and if you guys use Lightning, it's already kind of hard-coded into your Lightning where you can start a poll in 5 seconds. Yeah, it's pretty easy. Yeah. Did anyone else have any questions? And it doesn't have to be on anything I touched on. It could be something that you're running into as an admin or something that you may want to tell the rest of us that works for you. Yeah?
Starting slide, you show 10 apps, right? It's like, if I need to go to my leadership and they want a kind of estimate, like if the app exchange request cannot be ad hoc. Like just we have 3 apps very similar only for email to Salesforce only in this lobby. So sometimes it becomes very confusing. First of all, what are your best practices for figuring the right kind of apps?
So my, and that's the perfect example. There's always five different apps to do what you want to do, right? So you need to come up with your own specs, okay? You need to figure out what exactly, not just, you know, I need an email app, but what do I need this email app to do? I want it to be able to, you know, mark records in Salesforce. I want to maybe be able to create opportunities from there, or I don't want to be able to create opportunities from there. I want to have a lot of control over what the users do, or I want them to have the ability to configure certain things themselves. So you start to figure out what specifications that that product would need. And then, again, you reach out to your super users, and you reach out to your stakeholders, and you ask them, hey, what do you think we should do with this? What process do you think we could also help if we had this application? A lot of times, it's so funny, every time I talk to finance, they're always like, well, you know what? We could do something with SAP. And I'm like, yeah, okay. So now, not only are we coming out of my budget, we can get half of it out of your budget, and it makes everything work a lot smoothly for everyone else, because now we're a team trying to get a new application rather than just me, you know, the sales operations person trying to do it. It's always better when you can come with a group of people that are on the same accord that I'm music references, right, that want the same thing. Yes? See, I've worked with a company that was, even though my company deals with big data more than anything, so we're not techie in that other way. I used to work for Weatherbug, and that was a company that I first learned Salesforce off of, and because they were making all these different meteorological tools, et cetera, our IT department was just stellar. Like, you could just give them something, and they would be able to bang it out in like a day and a half, right? So definitely, that's another good group. And some companies do have their Salesforce admin role under their IT department, but that's always a good group to reach out to, because a lot of that stuff, if you have someone that has even worked with Salesforce before in Apex Code, they can definitely create it, and you don't have to pay for that development.
But do you recommend that? Because I personally would want to take an app from Appexchange rather asking my development team to build that.
It depends on there. Like, I wouldn't do it at this company, right? Just because that's not how our tech department works. At the other company I worked for, during Christmas, they would put up Christmas lights that turned on and off to the music, and this was 11 years ago. So we just had a very creative tech department that was willing to do anything, try it, and they just were very well-versed. So it depends on, like, but I understand, like, right now, they're even so busy that I wouldn't even ask them. I would just go and see how much it would cost for the company to develop it, and then put that into my proposal.
Yeah.
They kind of have a team now where you can reach out to actually the success group, and they actually have sessions that you can go to online that are on specific topics. So you want to go to a session, you can actually go online, and the success community will, you know, the Salesforce expert will be on there. And it's interactive. They like to have small groups. So you can actually, you're actually asking them questions and talking. It's not just something where you're muted out the line. You're actually having, you know, a conversation with these experts. So definitely, I think that's something else that's wonderful that I should have put on the board. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I just want to add a couple of things to your question. In one assessment you have made, it costs anywhere between 8 to 12 times the annual license cost to build your own product of equivalent functionality.
Okay.
But you might want to do it if you have a very vertical requirement. If you've got something that's very specific to your business, you might want to build that. That's one story. The other story we hear is every engineering assessment is off by 60%.
That's a good statistic to know. Yeah, don't do it. Yeah. Yes, ma'am, I saw your hand.
It sounds like it's beginning admin and advanced admin. And I'm just going to say if it's beginning admin, turn on your field history now.
Yeah.
Check all 20 boxes whether or not you think you're going to use it. And the other thing I found very useful is when I make like validation rules, I'll put a line in there to exclude me when I have to do a mass update. Because what I'll do is even on my user ID, I'll exclude from rule yes, no. And only I'm the only person who can complete that field. So in my line of my validation code, I'll say, if equals blank, run the rule, but otherwise I can quickly say yes or something, check box. And then so when I have to do a mass update, I don't get stopped by all those delegations.
Yeah. That's the other good thing about Jitterbit, because you can bypass some of the rules if you upload.
I have clients that don't have that budget.
Yeah. You can get it free for, I think, 30 days now. But that's all. Turn on. Yeah. You can do that. You can do that. Yes. Any applications that give them access?
For the list you had,
right. Mm-hmm.
Do you have a drum to help you administer when you have an issue in production and you want to direct your team to support it? Or are you, they waking you up and you're going along?
Well, there is a website that you can go to that just actually looks at, and I do apologize because I don't know what it is. I have it on my saved, it's one of my favorites. But it actually looks at, let me just try to get out of here for a second. Okay, so you guys are going to look at some. No, that's okay. But it actually looks at your up and your downtime. So, trust? Yeah, okay, trust.salesforce.com. It actually looks at if your Salesforce org went down. And then sometimes it doesn't go down. But you may lose functionality in your case object or something like that. So it will actually show you that information and you're able to kind of figure out, hey, what went wrong and make sure it wasn't you or a change you made and it was maybe something else that, you know, something on the Salesforce side that caused the error. Audit trail, yes. You can download 6 months of your audit trail. That'll show different fields. Yeah. Yeah. It'll show which fields have been changed, which records have been deleted, which reports have been deleted, et cetera. So if you have one of those people that are admins that like to just go and change stuff on the fly, you can definitely see what they've been doing so that you can make sure that you know whether or not it was you or it was maybe something else that did it. Yeah. Does Did I have any more questions? I don't know if we're at time. I'm sorry to off my watch today. Okay, well, I hope all of you guys are successful with Salesforce. Definitely join some groups, get out there, meet new people. That's the best way to learn different processes that you should probably implement to be more successful. And have a great day.
Thank you.